Good evening. I'm Al Sanders.
And I'm Richard Scher for the vacationing Jerry Turner.
Right now, 1,400 blue-collar workers are deciding whether to accept the latest offers from six area hospitals or walk off the job. So far, only a tentative agreement stands in the face of the 7 a.m. tomorrow strike deadline. We have team coverage of the strike threat, beginning with this report from George Bauman.
It was close to 1 o'clock this morning, the end of a 15-hour bargaining session, when District 1199E of the Hospital and Healthcare Employees Union reached a tentative contract agreement with Johns Hopkins Hospital. A union official called it a fairly decent settlement. This morning, union members employed at Hopkins left a closed-door meeting at union headquarters refusing comment on the agreement, which had been explained to them and on which they had voted. Details are being withheld until other Hopkins workers vote tonight. So this is where the situation stands at the moment. Negotiations continuing at Lutheran, Maryland General, GBMC, and Provident. A tentative settlement with Johns Hopkins, the largest employer. And no talks scheduled with Sinai. At a news conference this morning, Union President Ronald Holley said this of the chance for an agreement with Sinai.
It is my belief that we would probably have a strike at Sinai. I think the mentality of the administration and the negotiation leader is that we will have no choice but to strike Sinai Hospital.
Workers at Sinai and other affected hospitals, except Hopkins, met this morning and voted in closed session on the latest proposals of those institutions, and many were unhappy as they left.
Now, what do you all think?
I think we're going to strike.
What hospital?
GBMC.
Sinai as well. All of them.
GBMC? All of
yes.
GBMC going?
Yeah, we going.
Fight, fight, fight.
There'll be a second meeting of the union's daytime workers at 7 o'clock tonight. The union expects to have the results of the balloting by 10 p.m. George Bauman, Channel 13, Eyewitness News.
I'm Beverly Burke reporting. A strike watch goes into effect here at Sinai Hospital 12 hours before the threatened walkout of union workers, 7 a.m. tomorrow morning. If there's a strike, hospital officials say patients should not be concerned about the quality of service. 87-year-old Louis LeBeau was just admitted for some upcoming surgery. Are you a little concerned about health care, the service you'll get here as a patient if there is a strike?
Yes.
What concerns you?
Well, we'll keep saying you're getting, the, you know, decent health care. We'll get a sufficient amount of people to take care of us.
Well, I'm quite sure in a little establishment like this, they have some sort of backup. They would have to have some sort of backup.
We do not anticipate cutting back in any way our inpatient services nor our surgical cases.
It's not doctors or nurses threatening to walk out, but those in support services, housekeepers, laundry handlers, those who make up, pick up, and deliver meals, medical supplies handlers, maintenance and engineering, and the largest group at Sinai, the Department of Nursing Services. They keep patient records and function as ward secretaries. Volunteers are trained to replace them.
The training has been very comprehensive in terms of what they can and cannot do. Also, they're walking into shops which have in many respects anticipated this action, and there's been a good deal of stockpiling.
There's some feeling a strike by hospital workers would serve no purpose.
But at this point, I don't feel that the people should be striking at all. The hospitals are having financial difficulties.
Strikes are designed to demonstrate how operations don't run smoothly when the workers are not there to do their jobs. If there is a strike, Sinai Hospital will have the job of demonstrating how to keep things running smoothly. Beverly Burke, Channel 13, Eyewitness News.
It has been 4 years since members of 1199E struck Sinai Hospital. Sinai officials say anyone with questions about patient care can call and get specific information. Right now, Eyewitness News is headed to the scene where a city police officer has been shot. Now, we know what that kind of word must do to the many families of police officers in the city. Right now, details are sketchy, but the shooting apparently took place during a narcotics raid in the 1800 block of Frederick Avenue. We will have more from the scene of the shooting later in this newscast.
And now back to the labor front. Workers at the Domino Sugar Refinery in South Baltimore have given the company's offer for a new contract back to company officials. But these same workers have agreed to call in a federal mediator in an attempt to avoid a strike. Members of Local 392 of the United Food and Commercial Workers Union say they will stay on the job, working under the terms of their old contract during mediation. The workers want higher pay and increased fringe benefits. Mayor Schaefer needs to find over $1 million if the Urban Inn, a hotel training center, can move forward. That's because the U.S. Housing and Urban Development Agency has decided the city violated too many federal rules to allow it to continue with HUD funding. The city has begun renovating three buildings in the 1100 block of North Calvert Street for the training facility. The mayor is expected to talk at the center tomorrow at a news conference.
Schaefer was also on hand today to help out with the kickoff of major renovations to the Pratt Library. They're spending close to $3.5 million to spruce up the Pratt downtown. His honor helped fill in a mural created by students from school number 33. The state and city are footing the price of renovations to the library. They're expected to be completed in 1986. Local holiday toy drives have a much more immediate deadline. And with Christmas rapidly approaching, Don Scott reports the annual drives say that two of them at least, that this is one of their worst years ever.
11-month-old Tommy there is checking out the toys, new and used, his family has been collecting for weeks now to give to those less fortunate. And while you'd think a pile like this would make him and them smile, like some of the toys, instead they are all frowns here, because this year their drive is going nowhere.
We haven't had too many calls to collect toys. Like last year, we were way up. Well, we had about 2,000 toys at this time. We're possibly about maybe 1,000 toys short of our goal of this time of the year, because we have about a 4,000 name list that we should be able to fill this year. We have a lot more organizations that we're working with.
One of the organizations in the past, Betty Willie says she's been able to help out with extra toys, is the Marines Toys for Tots campaign. And this year, they too could use some more help.
We're really deep in trouble. I would say we have to make up close to another 80,000 toys or so between another 3 weeks. I feel perhaps people think that there's still people that are not unemployed out there, and that's not the case. There's a lot of people still unemployed and a lot of needy people.
The number to call to help the Marines play Santa is 444-4545, 444-4545. If you'd like instead to help the other drive, its number is 522-3068, 522-3068. Any help will be much appreciated. In Northeast Baltimore, Don Scott, Channel 13, Eyewitness News.
Cash donations in lieu of toys are accepted by both groups, and the East Baltimore Drive needs someone with a truck to help them transport the toys they have.
Oh, by gosh, by golly, it is getting close to that time of Christmas trees and holly. And the American Legion has 7,500 trees as well as wreaths and hollies for sale again this year at Baltimore's Memorial Stadium. Proceeds benefit the Medical Eye Bank of Maryland. You'll find the Legionnaires at the stadium 7 days a week, right up until Christmas Eve. They hope to raise $20,000 this season.
Coming up, Baltimore's population takes a nosedive.
And some parents want to stop a three-year-old from attending a school because he has herpes. That story ahead on Channel 13's Eyewitness News. Tonight, some of the parents who have children at the Pasadena Elementary School are threatening to pull their children out of that school. Deborah Stone says they've heard of plans to admit a three-year-old child suffering from herpes into that school.
I think it's, you know, unusual to have a little boy with herpes in our school.
Students at Pasadena Elementary School echo the voices of their mothers and fathers. Parents here say they've been told very little about the young boy with herpes. They only know there's a plan to put the child in a class here for the learning and physically disabled. That information has been enough to cause some serious concern. Bill Shipp has two children enrolled at Pasadena, one in the special ed class where the child with herpes would reportedly be placed.
If it's diagnosed from birth as herpes, then and it's non-treatable, then they can't assure me that my kids are not going to get it. I want to know when he's coming, if he's coming, and then at that time, when he's here, my boys won't be here.
Some parents have already pulled their children out of school.
I pulled all three of my children out of school. I didn't send my kindergartner today, and I pulled my other two out of 205 this afternoon until it settled.
That child's going to have to walk down the same hallways our children walks down, use the same water fountains. I feel sorry for the child, but I think there's another way they can educate him. I don't think he should be exposed to all the children at Pasadena.
A spokesman for the Anne Arundel County School Board told us today that the child will not be placed in this school until the health of all other students can be safeguarded. Parents will meet with school officials tomorrow. They say it's going to take a lot to convince them. Deborah Stone, Channel 13, Eyewitness News.
Anne Arundel County school officials did not want to appear on camera today, but they did tell Eyewitness News there has been no final decision on when to admit the child to their school.
A man who died in a plane crash yesterday may have become ill during the takeoff. 57-year-old Leroy Bartow was killed when a single-engine plane ran off a runway near Clinton, Maryland. And investigators says that witnesses saw him slump over the controls as he tried to take off. Bartow was trying out the homemade aircraft when the accident occurred. Transportation and television are two major items on tonight's City Council agenda.
And Alex Dimitrik standing by with his live Instant Eye report from outside City Hall. Alex?
Alan, Richard, between the rubber and the road, the City of Baltimore may be prepared to spend a good deal of money to smooth things out on the Jones Fall Expressway. Now, to fill in all those cracks and potholes, three bills have been introduced tonight which would refurbish the JFX and, in some places, outright replace it. The repair work would stretch from the northern city line to Chase Street, and the $15 million is the city's share of a $100 million overall project. The rest of that money would come from the federal government if and when the federal government ever clears up some red tape. The other interesting bit of legislation concerns the cable television issue, an issue that has been running longer than most television shows. A new bid is in from United Cable, which will put up millions of dollars and give the city a chunk of the profits.
All in all, it looks very good. And the fact of the matter is that 8 out of 10 people in the city of Baltimore want cable because their surrounding areas have cable and they've heard so much about it. So I think the council will see fit to award the United this particular contract.
One item that did not do so well tonight is the so-called gay rights bill. As they have all along, members of the gay community have been holding a vigil at City Hall until the bill comes up for a vote. But tonight, the council has tabled taking action until at least after the first part of the year, a big disappointment for supporters of that equal rights measure. And that's the latest from City Hall. Richard, now back to you.
All right, thank you. That's Alex Dimitrik with a live Instant Eye report from tonight's City Council meeting. Well, tonight also finds Baltimore welcoming yet another hotel to the fold. This evening, Days Inn of America held the grand opening of its new facility at Hopkins Place. Officials presented Mayor Schaefer with a $5,000 donation in appreciation for help the chain received from the city's Starters program. It's designed to offer free pre-screening, referral, and training services to Baltimore businesses.
Well, the business of the Census Bureau is counting heads, and tonight the numbers are out for the state of Maryland. According to the new U.S. Census report, the number of Baltimore City residents is declining less rapidly than before. The city's mid-1983 population was down by 10,541 from 1980, but the average annual population drop was only two-thirds of its former pace. The census also found that 17 of Maryland's 23 counties have grown since 1980. Well, the state's lotto jackpot has grown substantially since Saturday. There was no winner in last Saturday evening's drawing here on 13, which means next week's grand prize will be worth at least $2.5 million, Al.
Mm-hmm. Pull out an extra blanket, says Robert, huh? Next, he is with the AccuWeather cold forecast.
And one huge Christmas tree arrives in the nation's capital. That's and more news next on Channel 13's Eyewitness News.
Bleak morning. Beautiful afternoon.
Right.
And now what?
Colder. It's just going to get colder. It is December, remember?
Yes. I haven't forgotten.
Remember December. And it is snowing somewhere in the east tonight. Northwestern Massachusetts, across Vermont into New Hampshire and Maine. As much as 6 to 8 inches of snow will fall. 5 inches already in Burlington, Vermont. Colder air up there. The storm that moved through our region with the showers and the rain this morning and last night did develop off the Atlantic coast, and the cold air moved in ahead of it up to our north. But now, as the precipitation is well out to the east, our cold air is starting to filter in very, very slowly. This afternoon, a very pleasant high of 55 degrees as winds are out of the west. Now they're starting to come in out of the northwest, and temperatures are going to start to drop. Clear skies generally in the region, a few clouds out to our west. Currently, under those generally clear skies in the Baltimore area, temperatures have dropped into the upper 40s. As skies continue to clear out, they'll continue to drop. Winds out of the west, 14, gusting to near 22. It's going to seem a lot colder later on tonight as the winds do pick up and the temperature starts to drop. Humidity 47%, barometer rising 30.02 inches. The air quality is good at 45 this afternoon. And your tides, sunrise and sunset. And that's not going to change much for the next 3 weeks. The sunset is exactly the same for the next 3 weeks. By the way, up in Caribou, Maine, the sunset this afternoon at 3:58 in the afternoon. Colder weather coming into the west, already down to 25. A couple of snow flurries up in Bradford, PA. 30 in Pittsburgh, 34 in Morgantown. The colder air is starting to sift into the eastern part of our state. in the upper 40s, mid 40s to our east, some low 50s down to our south. Winds from out of the west, northwest, 12 to 22. That will seem much colder than the 40, 42 degree high that we're predicting. Looking at our radar locally, nothing at all in the way of precip. Generally clear skies. A few clouds will drift through, but no precip expected. Across the United States, this is what we're watching. Southern Texas, some moisture building down there. Could give us some snow Wednesday night or Thursday morning. Snow, as you can see right now, across portions of New Hampshire, Vermont, extreme southeastern New York State getting a little mixture. New York getting just rain and rain off coast, and that's moving to the northeast. Generally a dry air mass moving in, but let's take a look at our cloud cover. We'll see what's developing down to our south and west. And here you see it. Some moisture already starting to move into southern Texas, and a lot of moisture sitting in the Gulf. A storm moving across the extreme southern part of Nevada tonight into Arizona. It's going to pick up more moisture, and as it develops and grows across the United States, we do expect a band of precip to develop across the central part of the United States and move toward our region Wednesday night and Thursday. Now, there's a lot of cold air sitting and in place, starting to move into place to our north and to our west. And all this cold air sitting here does set up the possibility of a band of snow developing sometime Wednesday night or Thursday. Now, what will happen is this. If the storm gets here a little sooner, the cold air will be firmer entrenched and there's a better chance of more accumulating snow. If the storm just takes this little old time and doesn't get here till Thursday afternoon, we'll probably see a little bit of snow and then just a change over to rain as warmer air comes in ahead of that storm. It'll be cold for the next couple of days, and following that storm, some more chilly air, Arctic air, moves in later in the weekend. Tonight, clear, breezy, and colder than it has been, 24 to 30. Wind chills tonight will be less than 10 to 15 degrees. You should dress warmly tonight if you're going out. Sunny, windy, and cold tomorrow. High of only 38 to 43. Normal is now 49. Low tomorrow night, 18 to 25. Normal is around 29. So we're going to be dropping down below normal. And we'll watch that storm this week as it develops. Could be interesting by Thursday morning.
All right, Robert.
Okay.
Well, you've sold some houses in your day.
Yes,
listen
I
to
suppose.
This. Tonight, show host Johnny Carson tops our list of people making news tonight. The talk show host has set a Malibu real estate record for the largest purchase ever for a single family house in Malibu. Listen to this, Robert. Johnny Carson spent $9.5 million for the house. Just completed last year, he bought it with all the furnishings inside. Successful movie roles are based on sound research of the facts. So says actor Tim Hulce, who portrays Mozart in the movie Amadeus. For example, Mozart's crazy laugh is referred to in letters written by Mozart's acquaintances. Hulce also took piano lessons to better understand the genius who rebelled against authority, married badly, gambled obsessively, drank, danced, and rolled around a lot. And this year's National Christmas Tree arrived in Washington late this afternoon from northern Minnesota. All 60 feet of this beautiful white spruce. It will be decorated with 7,000 ornaments and 4,000 lights.
Real Estate Commission, that would be what?
7%?
57,000? Something?
500 and some thousand.
500 and something, yes. Oh my. Still to come on Eyewitness News, the Colts may send head coach Frank Kush packing. Mayflower probably standing by. Lou Tilley will have all the sports. You'll get a look at a dog that's sniffing out trouble and saving beekeepers a bundle. And the man with the artificial heart speaks out. You'll hear what he has to say when Eyewitness News continues. A three-car accident late this afternoon on Eastern Avenue near the East Point Shopping Center has left three people injured. They include a woman who was driving an Atwater cab and two men in one of the other vehicles. An eyewitness told Frank Luber that the cab was heading west when it suddenly jumped the median strip and struck another car broadside. This is what the eyewitness had to say to Frank.
The taxi come across the median strip and hit this green car broadside. Knocked it all the way off the road and hit the other car. Hit the third car, yes.
Did the people in the green car fall out of the car or what? Or they just got out on their own?
They fell out. They were knocked out.
The three victims were transported by ambulance to the Key Hospital. Names of the victims and their condition not yet known, although paramedics on the scene of the accident told Eyewitness News the cab driver may have suffered a cervical injury. Police are still on the scene investigating. William Schrader began his second week on his artificial heart by saying that he's ready to go fishing and watch ball games. His doctors have taken him off the critical list and say his progress has exceeded their expectations. Our doctor on call, Dr. Joanna Shaw, is here to tell us what doctors are checking him for this week.
Well, Al, the major concern is infection in his blood or in his lungs or in his incision. But considering that today could have been his funeral before the artificial heart surgeons gave him only a week to live, he is doing extremely well.
Fantastic. It's just a complete turnaround. Good feeling.
And how you feel? Or
I can breathe. I can breathe so normally that it's nothing like anything I just experienced before.
Schrader is comfortable with his new plastic heart.
Yes, you can feel it. It's just like a thrashing machine. The old-time thrash machine. And it's just pumping like everything.
But it doesn't hurt you.
Oh, no.
Schrader's doctors hope that he will avoid one hurdle that may follow all major surgery, infection. Because heart patients get drugs during the operation and for several days afterwards in hopes of preventing infection, it takes up to a week or two for symptoms to show up. Schrader's diabetes makes him more vulnerable than most people. But studies have shown that as many as one out of three people undergoing surgery gets an infection in the hospital. Tubes placed in the body, for example, for drainage or for the compressed air to power the artificial heart, can act as a pathway for contamination by bacteria. Hospital bugs are tougher to treat than bugs acquired in the community. That's because disinfectants and antibiotics that we use in the hospital kill off the weaker germs and leave rare and resistant strains. Because infections can spread from person to person, people around Schrader are gowned and masked. Schrader's temperature and white blood cell count have come back towards normal, a good sign.
I feel like I got 10 years going right now.
Well, we hope you do.
If Schrader continues to do well, he may be moved out of intensive care at the end of this week. Richard?
Well, Joe, if you've been trying to save on calories by using artificial sweeteners, tonight's Health Watch report may be very sobering. A Yale University expert says that you're only delaying your craving for sugar and not actually getting rid of it. Social psychologist Judith Roden says that someone who has a saccharin-sweetened snack at 2 o'clock is more likely to want a piece of cake at 4 o'clock. Well, the next few days we'll find the city conducting so-called float tests of its fire hydrants. Officials say they'll cause muddy water for 1 to 2 hours in each of the areas during the testing. The testing, which is expected to be completed by next Saturday.
Well, the tide has certainly turned at a Glen Burnie nursing home. The state health department has renewed the license of what was formerly the Manor Nursing Home. Officials say the new owners of what is now the Arundel Geriatric and Nursing Center have made great strides in bringing it up to state standards. The home's license was revoked a year ago under its other owners. Maryland Congressman Perrin Mitchell could be spending the night behind bars. He was one of three protesters arrested at the South African embassy this afternoon. Mitchell, activist Dick Gregory, and AFL-CIO official Jocelyn Williams were protesting South Africa's policy of racial segregation and its recent arrests of labor leaders. It's expected all three will choose to spend the night in jail.
Well, tonight Maryland's bee industry is enlisting the help of man's best friend. Frank Luber says a dog is being used to sniff out diseased bees that could spread to other bee colonies in the state.
Max is a 3-year-old Labrador retriever, and his job is to sniff out a bacteria known as American foul brood in beehives.
Research. Good dog. Good boy. Sit.
The barking doesn't really mean anything other than he's excited. The cue that there's a diseased colony is the fact that he sits.
This is just not a routine to test a dog's ability to smell. It also is most important to the state's bee industry. Sit here. And to the Maryland agriculture industry as well. And Max here represents a potential savings of thousands and thousands of dollars, right? Up till now, human inspectors had to inspect each of the 16,000 bee colonies in the state. And it's impossible for humans to inspect bees in the winter, but not for a dog.
He can inspect 50 colonies in 10 minutes. I can inspect 50 colonies maybe in 5 hours.
For the farmer and orchard grower, Max is worth his weight in gold. The bacteria he sniffs out is always fatal to a bee colony and may spread, killing others, which would have a profound effect on pollination efforts.
Bees are rented in the orchards in western Maryland and on the eastern shore for lima beans, melons, cucumbers, watermelons.
Max was trained by the Baltimore County K-9 Unit Sergeant Morris Pierce. Once Max became familiar with the bacteria scent, he was able to search for the odor and earn his reward, a rubber ball to play with.
And Max, what have you found here?
No.
He's got a microphone, a diseased microphone.
Max also has a little ham in him, which reminds us pigs have the greatest sense of smell, even more so than Max. But pigs won't heal.
I'm Frank Luber, Channel 13, Eyewitness News.
Well, using Max and his marvelous nose, the Agriculture Department will be able to inspect bee colonies more often. They'll help detect bacteria at very low levels that could be missed by human inspectors.
We told you earlier tonight of the shooting of a city police officer during a narcotics raid. Well, Deborah Stone is live on the scene right now in the 1800 block of Frederick Avenue, and she has more. Deborah?
Al, we've just received some information just a few minutes ago. As you said, we are in the 1800 block of Frederick Avenue. Just a short while ago, there was a shooting here. A narcotics officer taking part in a raid was shot in a home here. One suspect has been taken into custody. Right now, police are trying to determine more of what took place. And with me right now is Michael Bass of the Baltimore City Police Department to fill us in. Can you give us an idea of exactly what happened?
Essentially, what we know at this hour, and it's still, as you can well imagine, rather sketchy. As I understand the situation, just before 6 o'clock, members of the drug enforcement section were here in the 1800 block of Frederick Avenue. An officer was inside, plainclothes undercover officer was inside of a third floor apartment where he was transacting, I believe at this hour, a narcotics purchase. This was in conjunction with a search and seizure that was to have been served simultaneously at the time of this purchase. Something occurred with inside the apartment. We don't know at this hour what that was, but as other officers entered the building to execute the warrant, gunshots were heard. Once officers were able to have the suspect surrender, they entered the apartment building and found our officer there in the building, shot in the apartment.
And he was pronounced dead on the scene, it is my understanding.
I understand that he was pronounced dead a short time later by responding ambulance personnel.
And a suspect has been taken into custody.
The suspect was taken into custody several minutes later after he had not only had his own weapon but had taken the officer's weapon, and units that were pleading with him to surrender compelled him to eventually throw the weapons out, and he surrendered.
All right, thank you very much, Michael Bass of the Baltimore City Police Department. As we said, an officer, Baltimore City police officer, has been shot and killed. One suspect taken into custody. So far, police have not released any information as to whether they have indeed found any narcotics on the scene. Back to you,
Deborah, it's Al back at TV Hill. I assume that because the officer's family has not been notified, we have not been given the name, right?
That's exactly right. Police have not released the name of the police officer, and I'm sure that we will know that later this evening.
Yeah. Of course, again, that still does not relieve the fears of the families of so many officers who are in the narcotics squad. But that's as much as we have at this hour. Thank you. Deborah Stone reporting live on the officer who's been shot. And the word we get is that officer is dead in the 1800 block of Frederick Avenue. Mm.
Still ahead on Eyewitness News, we turn to sports. The Orioles are already doing their Christmas shopping.
And Loyola gets set to move into a spanking new home. Lou Tilley is next with all the sports when Eyewitness News continues.
Well, Bob Turk was talking about a possibility of snow, and you're talking about our favorite sport in the spring.
Baseball.
Yes.
Baseball. I just got back from Wichita, and it's a long flight back from Wichita. We're
to play. Particularly the way that game lost. Yeah.
I'm telling you. We'll take a look at that in a minute. But first, the baseball news, and there is plenty of beef available, but is the prize worth the price? The annual baseball winter meeting's underway in Houston, Texas, with the Orioles first in line when they opened the candy store today. Now, the object of the bird's desire through a trade is this man, fleet of foot, quick of bat, strong of arm, Ricky Henderson. The hang-up, Henderson is in the last year of a contract. So even if Hank Peters pulls off a deal with the A's, and that would come at a high price, say a starting pitcher and Mike Young, even if they make a deal, they'd still have to re-sign Henderson after the 85 season, and the price will be astronomical. And you want to improve your club, but you don't want to break the bank. And if you think it's getting that serious, and if you think it's not, well, baseball's new commissioner, Peter Uberoth, in the meeting's opening address today, says that local franchises are being seriously hurt by super stations, TV stations, who cut into the local TV revenue.
And the networks tell me that with the saturation, when this television contract is done, television revenues will come down. And if there's a sharp drop in revenues from any source in baseball, then baseball will be in some real serious trouble. When there's 7 baseball clubs for sale, that's not healthy. That's the evidence that there's a problem.
Peter Ueberroth today at the opening of baseball's winter meetings in Houston. Well, now, how about this one? Frank Kush quitting on the Colts. Well, that's the word out of Indy and Arizona today. That after the Ursays got beat by that bastion of big league ball, the Buffalo Bills, yesterday. Now, the word is that Kush will quit at the end of the regular season and take over as the new coach of the USFL's Arizona Wranglers. I'll tell you, that's what most insiders have speculated on all along, if Ursay didn't move the Colts back to Kush's old grazing grounds in the first place. Now, in golf, it's not how you drive, it's how you arrive. That's what they say. In pro football, it's the club that peaks at playoff time, and the Raiders may be right back on track. Battle of the Giants yesterday, Orange Bowl. Young Dan Marino is on target to Jimmy Cefalo. And with that, Marino, the sophomore sensation, sets the all-time NFL record with his 37th touchdown pass this year. He also got 38, 39, and 40. However, Mike Haynes picks this one off in the fourth quarter. Earlier, he returned 197 yards for a touchdown. He stopped this time, but it sets up a Marcus Allen touchdown. And then with the game on the line, the remarkable Allen breaks one off the right guard, a lightning bolt for the end zone, 52 yards to seal a 45-34 win for the defending champions yesterday over the Miami Dolphins. The Chicago Bears have already clinched a playoff berth as one of the year's big surprise stories in the NFL. Tonight at 9 o'clock, the Bears against Dan Fouts and the San Diego Chargers right here on Channel 13, Monday Night Football. Now, last night here on Channel 13, we were in Wichita to see the Wings jump out 5-2 on the blast. But with 6 minutes left, Buriano makes it 5-4. Cooper, loosen the collar. We're going to the final minute. The Blast trying to tie. Michael Collins to Dave McWilliams, and we are. And now it really gets crazy. 13 minutes into overtime, and the Wings' Kevin Cooley will break in all alone on Scott Manning. And Manning cuts it off, but Ray Kunavants, the Blast zone defender, knocks it into his own goal, and it's 6-5 Wichita in overtime. Next up, L.A. Saturday night, and it may take Coop's troops that long to get over that tough loss last night in Wichita. Well, on the local scene, there's a new look at Loyola College, and Jim Brinson fills in the picture.
This is the new look for Loyola's Greyhounds, a brand new gymnasium, and virtually a team which is going to be high pressure, intense style of play. Head coach Mark Amatucci says that the Greyhounds are here to run.
Our assets are quickness and aggressiveness on both the offensive and defensive end of the court. And we feel if we can cause a little chaos defensively and take people out of their offense that, you know, we're going to get a lot of easy transition baskets, and that's what we're suited for. You've got guys like Mo Hicks and Tommy Gormley, David Gately, and Pop Tubman, and, you know, you're talking about 4 guys that can light it up and really come up, put some pressure on people.
The Greyhounds open up against Holy Cross in their brand new facility.
Psychologically, it changes the whole atmosphere of the entire community here. You know, the kids now, when they walk in here, I mean, it looks like a major Division I situation, and I'm sure that's going to help them mentally. And like you said, if you bring a recruit in here, you know, now we don't have to hide the fact that we played in the old Evergreen, and we've got this beautiful facility to show off a little bit.
At Loyola, Jim Brinson, Eyewitness Sports.
From the Greyhounds now to the Thoroughbreds at Laurel Racecourse today, and in the 7th race, the 2-5. International Bank in top ranking, paid 48 and 80. In the 8th, a dead heat between the number 1 horse, My Dear Countess, and Fred's Mary Ann. So the 1-3 paid 660, or the 3-1 paid 760. In the 9th race, Taurus the Bill, Space Out, and Biddle Street Pete, 4-2 paid $46, and the 4-2-1 paid $620.10. And we're going to stay with running for a minute. Finally tonight, nice job to the folks who are putting the Maryland Marathon back on its feet. A lot of feet. A lot of very tired feet after yesterday's 26-plus mile jog. Anyway, it's back on the road again.
On the road again. Just can't wait to get on the road again. The life I love is making music with my friends. I can't wait to get on the road again. On the road again. Going places that I've never been. Seeing things that I may never see again. I can't wait to get on the road again.
Time is 2 hours, 20
what it's all about, the cheers at the finish line. Dave Schaefer from Middletown, Maryland, the first Maryland winner on the men's side, and Pat Millison from Timonium, and the 1,400 runners and the thousands that line the streets, all winners yesterday. I know we love to watch because we sure ain't going to be out there and run it.
Oh, I got in the swing of things yesterday.
Is that right?
You ran the marathon.
I walked into the kitchen.
Oh,
nice job, Al. Nice job.
I'm getting there.
And I flew to Wichita.
Right. Yes, you did.
Thank you.
All right. President Reagan has given the 7th Annual Lifetime Achievement Awards. The president handed out the awards at the White House. This year's crop of high achievers included Lena Horne, Danny Kaye, and Arthur Miller. Winners were entertained at the Kennedy Center by Dionne Warwick and other performers.
Still ahead, Michael Olesker looks at a legend of sorts on the streets of Baltimore.
And a long-awaited vehicle is finally about to show up on showroom floors. That's all ahead on Eyewitness News.
General Motors dealers are getting a new product that they hope will make a big dent in the market for vans. It is the new Astro van, built at GM's Browning Highway plant. The van designed for companies that need small delivery vehicles and with families using station wagons. And for GM workers here in Baltimore, it represents future work if it sells. Dealers think it will.
Compared to the full-size van, maneuverability, the downsizing of it, yet you still maintain 80 to 90% of the cargo capacity of the full-size van.
Right now, only the cargo version is coming off the assembly line. The passenger version will come later. The Astro sells for about $8,000, and dealers report they've taken orders since August. A major American corporation, Union Carbide, is looking into a deadly gas leak at one of its plants. As residents of the Indian city of Bhopal lay sleeping this morning, a deadly gas seeped into their homes. The gas came from a Union Carbide pesticide plant, killing at least 304 people. The death toll is on the rise tonight. 10,000 people have been treated for gas-related injuries.
A leaky generator left one South Baltimore school in the dark today. Students at Southern High School got the day off. One of the generators at the school spouted fuel this morning. Workers at the school shut down the generator, cutting off most of the lights. Daylight didn't come to the rescue. The school's windows are few and far between, so students were sent home at noon. They'll be back in class tomorrow. Students in Chicago also had the day off today, and they could get a lot more. Their teachers are on strike. More than 430,000 students got a break when classes were canceled in the nation's third largest school district. The teachers are asking the Chicago School Board to give them raises and reinstate full medical benefits. They're taking a close look at the inside of Carroll County schools. The EPA found asbestos violations in the schools earlier this year, but the county calls the schools very safe and say most of the asbestos problems have been corrected. At any rate, county officials have 30 days to report their findings to the EPA.
Well, the problems of drug abuse are being answered by the Baltimore County Cocaine Hotline. More than 75 calls have come into the hotline, which has been operating for just 3 weeks. Hotline coordinator Mike Gimbel says that some calls have come from people actually on the drug at the time. Other callers have contacted the hotline to confirm drug use by their family and friends. The hotline, the number on your screen, 628-6120, 628-6120. It operates on weekdays only. The Metro Crime Alert Hotline is looking for information on the murder of 43-year-old Wendell Wilson Bizzell. A reward is being offered for information leading to the arrest and indictment of the murderer. Late Saturday night, November 24th, a woman was driving along Sands Road near Davidsonville in southern Anne Arundel County. Suddenly, she saw something strange along the road. As she slowed down, she could see a man laying near the edge of the highway. The woman called police. When they arrived, they found the body of Wendell Bizzell, dead from a single gunshot wound to the head. Anne Arundel County police have no suspects in this case, but they are looking for a brown 1973 Oldsmobile Delta with Washington, D.C. registration and tags numbers 739-722. Mr. Bizzell was last seen alive in this car on the morning of November 24th in Seat Pleasant, Maryland, a town near the Washington, D.C. line in Prince George's County. And if you have information on this murder, you can call the Metro Crime Alert's 24-hour hotline at 276-8888. You will remain anonymous, and you may be eligible for a reward of up to $1,000.
A Rockville firefighter has filed a $500,000 lawsuit for injuries received in what was supposed to be a friendly game of hockey. Stefan Ventura is suing the Baltimore Firefighters Union. He says he was punched in the eye during a firefighters hockey game last March at the Civic Center. The union says it didn't sponsor the game. It only donated some of the jerseys worn by the players. And Baltimore lost one of its more colorful characters over the weekend when Sylvan Bass, the former boxer and bouncer on the block, passed away at age 75. In his commentary tonight, Michael Olesker says Bass was one of a kind.
Oh, he was. He was a throwback to another era, Al. Sylvan Bass might have been invented by Damon Runyon and put together with Play-Doh, a big, beefy guy with a cigar sticking out of the corner of his mouth. He had a wayward grasp of the English language that Runyon would have loved. A little girl came out as a three-year-old broad when described by Bass. A knockout punch became a coup de snore. At heart, he was a gentle, good-natured fellow who looked like a behemoth when he made a fist. In the boxing ring, he fought an incredible 285 fights. It was simple, he said. He needed to eat. At 13, in a poor East Baltimore neighborhood, he started boxing in a combination pool hall and barber shop. At one point, as a pro, he won an astonishing 65 fights in a row. Again, it was simple. He once joked, "I just clamped down my size 12 foot on top of the other guy's foot, and then I keep throwing my hands at his head." But to a generation that arrived after his heyday, Sylvan Bass was known for the life he led outside the ring. He was no wallflower. There were gambling escapades. There were days and nights playing bouncer on the block. In fact, some called Sylvan Bass the mayor of the block. They'll miss him down there. He was a throwback to a very colorful time. I'm Michael Olesker.
Thank you, Mike. Bob Turk is next with the AccuWeather 5-day forecast.
And with the new year just around the corner, Denise Koch shows us what people are rushing out to buy. All next on Channel 13's Eyewitness News. Updating our top story tonight, a Baltimore City narcotics officer shot and killed during a drug raid in the 1800 block of Frederick Avenue about an hour and a half ago. Deborah Stone, live on Frederick Avenue with an update. Deborah?
We are standing in the 1800 block of Frederick Avenue, where just before 6 o'clock this evening, a narcotics officer, as you said, was shot and killed. The officer was in the process of making a narcotics raid. We do not have details on exactly what happened, but we do know that the officer had been here for some time and other officers were on their way into the building when the officer was shot. We do not have the name of the Baltimore City police officer. Right now, we are told family members are being informed, so we will have that information later this evening. One suspect, we are told, has been taken into custody. He is being questioned right now. Police do not know exactly what took place, but they are investigating, and we should have more information on Eyewitness News tonight at 11 o'clock.
All right, thank you very much. Deborah Stone reporting live on this continuing story, the shooting death of a city police officer, a narcotics officer in the 1800 block of Frederick Avenue, and more tonight at after the football game.
Coming up tonight at 11, of course, again, we will have more on that city police officer who's been shot and killed. Alex Dimitrik will tell us if it's work or walk for employees of six local hospitals. Denise Koch will be at the movie. She'll tell you if you should be, too, to see Just the Way You Are. And Lou Tilley will have highlights as local teams take it to the hoop. All that and more coming up right after Monday Night Football. Now let's go to Bob. Look 5 days ahead where I think it's going to get colder. Right, Robert?
Correct, Al. It's going to stay cold this week and get even colder by the latter part of the weekend. And we do have a risk of some snow late Wednesday night, Thursday, and it'll depend on the track of the storm, how quickly it gets here, the amounts of snow. We just don't know right now. But there's definitely a chance at that time. Tonight, it'll be clear and getting quite a bit colder in the mid-20s to low 30s tomorrow. Sunny, breezy, and cold, a high of only 42. Sun followed by increasing clouds later in the day Wednesday. It could snow late Wednesday night. That's the earliest I think it could possibly get here, high of 40. Rain and or snow or some sleet, a mixture, perhaps a little snow in the morning and then some rain in the afternoon. Temperatures up to around 41 as the precip ends. Then partly sunny, 44 on Friday, and then turns colder for Saturday, high of only 39 under partly sunny conditions. Richard?
All right, Bob, thank you. Well, it is time to start thinking about your calendar for 1985. And this year, calendars are big Christmas items. Lifestyle specialist Denise Koch watched the months fly by today and saw calendars in all sizes and about all subjects.
I should say,
As a species, we seem to have always wanted to know what day it was, but lately, a number is not enough, and calendars feature every sort of enjoyment and activity you can imagine. If Tom Selleck's face smiled out at you as you learned it was Monday, would it be less blue? No matter your body part or type, they sell a calendar with its perfection.
Now, what's this thing with cats?
Well, everybody likes cats. Everybody does. I mean, every time you come in, every time someone comes in here, they want to get either dogs or cats.
Hit movies, movies that haven't hit town, heroes, and even great art. This woman is looking for the recently released Edgar Allan Poe calendar.
So I'm in quest of a calendar.
You know a Poe fan you're going to buy it for?
Yes. Yes, he's quite a devotee.
The final blow for me is this Trivial Pursuit, a little fact you'd like to know for every day of the year calendar. Now, wouldn't you just like to know, on Saturday, the 23rd of February, what the former name of John F. Kennedy Airport was? Is this for you?
No, it would be for my teenage child.
You think they'd like it?
It would be a surprise. Idlewild.
It seems to be the gift of the year for those who are hard to buy for. What it all means, I leave up to you.
This is going to a guy who's directing a program that I'm working for, and these two girls are helping him.
One girl gets frogs and one girl gets handsome men?
Oh my God, yes.
I'm Denise Koch, Channel 13, Eyewitness News. Okay.
Everybody rushing to see the year ahead, huh?
Oh yes.
Well, let it be.
All right. That is our report to the moment. The ABC World News tonight is next, followed by Evening Magazine at 7:30. I'm Richard Scherer.
And I'm Al Sanders for Jerry Turner and the entire Eyewitness News team. Back tonight, right after Monday Night Football. Yes.
Eyewitness News has been selected as Baltimore's outstanding news operation by both the Associated Press and United Press International.